Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City. It is again a Sunday and my house is almost done, so this will be gone soon. It's my flood beard. And let's get right into Jet Questions 89. Got some good ones this time. They're always good. A couple of these might be more difficult for me to answer, but that could be fun. Plus it's gonna involve a field trip, so get ready. All right, number one is, I didn't put a name to it. I apologize, sir, but your name is not on the list of questions. My mistake, but you will recognize it, and this is your answer. Hey, had this question for a while. In afterburning engines, there are flames leaving the engine and make those pretty mock diamonds. You can see them just slightly on our afterburner tests on some of them when the day is not quite so bright and sunny. Wouldn't this not produce any thrust and only burn up fuel, since the gas already left the nozzle and the flame won't accelerate the gas any further? If it actually still make more thrust, why is it? And if doesn't, why do they do it? Okay, I appreciate the enthusiasm, but you're basically asking everything here. You're asking for a full explanation of why, whether it does or whether it doesn't, and why either way. So that could take hours, and the actual real answer is mostly I don't know. But we've talked about afterburners before. Once the gases leave the engine, they are at very low pressure. Inside the jet pipe itself, there can be considerable pressure. Then there's a constricting nozzle. With afterburning, it's constricting and then diverging, or converging, diverging, condi nozzle. So the pressure in the jet pipe gets converted to velocity by the convergent. And then with afterburning, there is still some, I guess you'd call it pressure. The reason I'm looking at the sky is because subsonic aerodynamics and supersonic aerodynamics, the rules kind of switch. Everything changes. It's very confusing to me and to a lot of people. But the divergent portion of the nozzle, it constricts and then diverts. That divergent portion is very similar to the back end of a rocket engine. We've talked about this before many times. So the residual pressure in the supersonic exhaust gases allows them to expand against that wall or cone or bell and further push the aircraft forward. But once the gases have left the engine, there are shock waves caused by the nozzle and the interior of the engine that do things, make those mock diamonds. I don't know exactly how, I'm sorry. But all of the pressure that could push against the plane, the engine, the plane, and all of the acceleration of the gas that can be done within modern technologies has been done. And so there are some flames and incandescent carbon particles giving that glowing look to the gases in the exhaust, but that cannot be exploited by the engine to make thrust. If they could scoop that energy up and push the plane farther ahead, faster, they would. That's the best way I can explain it. So, there you go. Question number two is by Matias Escobar. His question is, if starting system is with high pressure air from APU air bleed, it's not with high pressure, it's with low pressure, high volume. It's about 90 horsepower worth of air at about 20 PSI. If you want to call 20 PSI high pressure, feel free, but I call that low pressure. High pressure, I think of things in excess of 100 PSI. How about that? Can you restart the jet engine at any moment? This is a vague question. It's a very complicated question. At any moment, no. You've made it easy for me. Can you restart the jet engine at any moment? No. But there are lots of situations where you can restart it. So that's a very long and convoluted answer. We've discussed it in this playlist before, so let's just move ahead. Thanks for making it easy for me. The old any moment thing, easy, no. All right, Corey and Zoltan asks, you showed us the starting air turbine for a few jets. Is it not possible to start the engines by injecting high pressure air directly after the HP compressor? Let's say in the same place or near from where the de-icing air is extracted. Another complicated question answer thing. Yes and no. Could you inject high pressure air after the HP compressor? Well, yes. There is a system that we're going to go on a field trip shortly, right now actually, and take a look at. The high pressure air is, I think it's about 120 psi, so we'll call it high pressure, high-ish pressure. Not highest, but high-ish pressure. It's taken from an external source. It's not taken from another engine, as far as I know. No, it's not. It's used in a specific situation, and the air is blasted through nozzles and impinges directly on the turbine. What does a turbine do? A turbine is a thing, like a windmill or a pinwheel, that's designed to take rushing gases and take the energy out of them to turn a shaft. And that's what you want to do when you want to start a jet engine, is you want to get it turning. So the turbine is used for its normal purpose. Its normal purpose is to take hot gases screaming through it, to turn that into mechanical power. And with the starting system we're going to look at, it takes cold air injected from an external source to supply enough power to just to get it going. So let's take a look at that now. It's called the air impingement starting system. All right, everybody. We are in the graveyard where only small bits and pieces are salvaged for use. Got the super shiny shades on because it's very bright outside. There's a bit of snow left, but we've had some unusually warm weather. And what we're looking for is, okay, those are compressor cases from LM1500s or J79s. We're looking for turbine cases, and why? Because you don't blow air onto a compressor to make things move. You blow air onto a turbine. Here's the basic rule you got to remember. A compressor moves air. A turbine is moved by air. That's the simplest way to remember it. Okay, so this is a forward end of an engine complete with, there's the front frame, the forward part of the compressor, the rear part of the high pressure part of the compressor. It's all one shaft, so we don't like to call it HPLP, but some people do. There's the midframe with the fuel nozzle bosses. That's the combustor outer case, and it ends. And where that flange bolts to right there is the turbine case. Here's three of them stacked on top of each other. And the bottom one has what we're looking for. That is the air impingement starter manifold. Air gets blasted in here from an off-engine source of high pressure air. And those little nozzles push against the, I think it's the IP, the middle stage, stage two of the turbine, to get it turning. You'll notice it's only along the top. There isn't one of those on the bottom because that's enough air to get things going. And it's cold air, so it causes no thermal stress on the blades. Very cool looking thing. And that's for a particular type of LM1500. It's not an aircraft engine. It's used for electrical power on, I think it's large ships in the US Navy. Anyway, it's a type of LM1500 called a PB104. And it is started not with an electric motor, not with an air turbine, but with the air impingement system, because on board a ship, you have lots of sources of compressed air. I bet you could even pump steam through that. High pressure steam. Maybe they did that. I don't know that. But I'm sure some of the old guys that were on those ships and maintained them and operated them would be able to tell us. So I'm waiting to hear from some old US Navy guys that were flying, not flying, we're serving on ships that used these for power generation. Very cool. Let's see if we can find a manifold off the engine. It's kind of neat. All right, this is the backyard. This is the true graveyard. Nothing here is ever going to be used again. This is a scrap stainless steel and Inconel pile. And I don't know if you can see, we're going to just approach this a little bit. There is an air impingement manifold in there that I'm going to dig out for you and show you. It's shown or featured in a video we made years and years ago. It's up to you guys to search and find the video I made with the air impingement starter manifold while an engine is running. Although we've never used the air impingement method to start an engine, it would be very noisy, I think. Could be fun. Could be fun. Hang on. Okay, we found a rather picturesque backdrop right there to showcase our air impingement manifold, air impingement starting manifold. And we use these engines by removing the manifold and putting little square block off plates on the engine cases to keep the gases from the turbine from escaping. Now this one here, I'm not sure if this is for display purposes or running. It's got to be for display because you couldn't block off turbine gases at 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit with a sheet of aluminum. If that was tried, that would have been the quick and dirty and lazy way to do it. But I really do think that's just for display or possibly shipping. Probably shipping. Anyway, looks kind of like a set of antlers, doesn't it? It would really be kind of cool if there was a right and a left set, but there isn't. So you couldn't make a metallic monster reindeer in your backyard by welding these up because there's only one side. Anyway. I think it's made of a fairly high temperature metal, although it doesn't handle high temperature air. It's exposed to it because in the operational engine you'd have a valve that shuts off the flow here, and then this is all exposed to the turbine gases, although they're not flowing through it, it's still exposed to that temperature. Kind of a cool, weird looking thing. Look at that. Oh, that's our air compressor. So, if you want one of these, they're in aircraft junkyards, if you can find one. And I think they might be stainless steel, maybe Inconel, probably stainless steel. I don't sell them. I don't sell anything. That ship has sailed a long time ago. But I may be convinced to trade for something cool. Possibly. Okay. That's your air impingement starting manifold that goes on the turbine cases of an LM1500 PB104. Well, folks, it's literally 1 minute later. You can tell because the compressor's still going. And look what I found laying on the ground. I think I found that valve. It's very, not as sophisticated as I thought. It's not an on-off valve. It's a one-way check valve. It's just, there's the matching flange. See that? Sorry the light's bad, but it's a winter afternoon. That's a one-way check valve. It's got a thing in there and a, where's the arrow? There's an arrow on here. Well, there it is. So it goes into that connection, and that connection matches up with, does it? Oh, okay. And it does, look at that. See that? That matches up with that perfectly. So there's your system. Bang, bang. So that's coming in from a compressed air line on the ship. Maybe steam. It's all metallic, so could work with either one. Very cool. Let's look a little closer. I would have thought this would be a spring to resist it, but apparently it doesn't matter which position it's in when the engine's not running. When you want to start it, you blow against it. Once it starts, it closes and stays closed. And it's all metallic, nothing else. So it can handle fairly high temperatures, stainless steel, all that stuff. And here we go. I've never seen one of those before. Okay, we don't have the big lights on. There's a compressor case for a 1500 and the matching other half. This is the front frame, I'm sure, for the same engine. That's not for this engine, that's from LM2500. Cleaned up by the S&S crew to be amazing. And this, of course, is the turbine out of the LM1500 turbine engine. And guess what? The turbine nozzle case, the turbine stator case, the turbine case, whatever, is one of the ones that used to be from a PB104. You can see our little handmade blanking plates, they go all the way around. And this one has been fully converted. Let me just tip this up on its end so I can show you better. Hang on. Okay, so the air impingement starter does hit the second stage of the turbine. First stage, second stage, third stage. Just about, I thought I was going to fall over. Okay, first stage, second stage, third stage. They're here. First stage, second stage, third stage. The nozzle for the first stage is the back of the, what would it be? The back of the combustor outer case. Yes, the combustor outer case is here, feeds the gas into the turbine. There's a set of nozzles right here that feeds the first stage, second stage, third stage. And the second stage nozzle, but we need more light. Hang on. Hang on. Here we go. Okay. The tip shrouds for the second stage nozzle, there's no holes in it. So normally there's elliptical holes that allows the air coming from the air impingement starter manifold to blast in there. And they're not there. So these shroud segments have been replaced at some point. They're not brand new. They've got experience. And they're what we call 180 degree shrouds. They go completely from one surface or one junction, one split line to the other. The old style are 60 degrees. There's three sections to each of these. This is the new stuff, the heavy duty stuff, the good stuff. So the shroud segments just slide in into a track. And these are the locator pins that keep them from spinning in their location when the engine's running. Here we go. All the little block off plates. Well, that was fun. Okay, and another short answer question. Long answer with a short version here. I do not, it's by John Bowles. He says, I do not understand how you get the shaft power out of that engine to turn the prop of the ship. Is the turbine in that engine or on the ship? Best regards. Well, again, it's always important to use proper terminology. So you're very close here. You're good. We're just going to polish it a little bit. So you say, is the turbine in that engine or on the ship? Well, if it's an LM1500, there is a turbine in the engine connected to the compressor. And that's how the engine works. We've covered that lots. And in my power turbine series of videos, I know they're a couple years old, but they have no expiry date. It all works just like that right now. There's another turbine connected to the engine with a pipe or a tube or a duct that can be long or short. It doesn't seem to matter a whole lot. It takes the pressurized, high-speed, high-temperature gases made by the engine or the gas generator. It's called a gas generator, technically. We've covered this before, too. And that power turbine is not connected to the engine by anything but a tube of gases. And it extracts the energy out of those rushing gases. It's connected to usually a gearbox, a reduction gearbox, and that reduction gearbox turns the shaft that does something. In your question, it's the one that turns the propeller on a ship. It can be do many things. So we've got diagrams and discussions of this in the power turbine videos. So have a look there. You will find them. If you type in power turbine to YouTube search engine, I'm right there. Okay. Oh, and this is another one by Corey and Zoltan. How'd you get two in there? Okay. In jet question 67, you explained that the power turbine is placed at some distance from the last HP turbine. We just talked about that. Why is it not closer to it, exactly like, let's say, the LP turbine in a twin shaft turbofan? Why is that expansion acceleration zone needed? It's not an expansion zone or an acceleration zone, and it's not needed. You could say that it's easier to have a great big gas turbine engine and a great big power turbine with 4 feet or 3 feet or 17 feet of space between them connected by a duct that really has no effect. I know you guys with the cars and the turbochargers think that wrapping it with heat insulating material would improve the efficiency. It does in a theoretical sense, but in a practical sense, it makes no difference. We've seen many installations and they just don't do that. There are other reasons for maintenance access or performance monitoring or condition monitoring, it's not done. Essentially, it's such a massive amount of energy. There is some heat radiated by the inter-turbine duct, you could call it. But it does not appear to be a matter of concern for any of the engineers who design or build or operate these things. As a matter of fact, there is a wind tunnel powered at the National Research Center in our nation, our great nation. And there's an ex-military turbojet being used as a gas generator. The exhaust is piped outdoors, out of the little shack that the engine's in. It's about about 60 feet in a tube. It goes straight up in a 90 degree corner, about another 60 feet, takes a 90 degree bend back about 30 to 40 feet, long ways, and then has a sharp 90 degree bend, another sharp 90 degree bend to blow that way now. Has about a 10 foot long pipe to the power turbine. All that convoluted, uninsulated, outdoor, in the wintertime tubing, and they've got more than enough power. It could literally be 2 feet long, but it's how many feet did I just say? It's like 200 feet long, 150 feet. It's a long ways, and it works great. So the advantage of that arrangement is the power turbine is way up in the air and it runs the giant propeller for the wind tunnel, and the engine is down on the ground in a little concrete building where the noise is controlled and it's got easier access for maintenance, rather than having the gas generator, the engine, way up in the middle of a giant wind tunnel facility. And look at that, it's right above me. So I guess theoretically there is some loss in total power output because of cooling of the gases that go from the gas generator to the power turbine, but it's not significant. That's the best answer I can give you. I think it would become significant in a very, very large facility concerned with only generating the maximum amount of power from the fuel that you have available. That would certainly be more important. But in many of these applications, the actual engine power is greater than what is needed, or the gas generator power, there's more headroom. There's headroom for more than what is ever going to be called upon, so there's flexibility in design of where you're going to put it, which really makes things a lot easier. So that's a really good question. I hope that was a half-assed answer. An answer for Corian Zoltan. Hey, and speaking of turbochargers, look at this one. It's actually not a turbocharger, but it's got a centrifugal compressor and an axial turbine. So it's related to a turbocharger, but it's a large step forward. This is from a small turbojet engine, the J44, which we're going to balance very soon. Belongs to Mr. Darren Duncan. Okay, so our bonus today, our bonus is from a YouTube viewer by the name of Joe Schmo, no capitals, Joe Schmo. He says, you strike me as the type who may have once upon a time worked on a government's black project. Makes me wonder if you ever have seen things that would be considered by many to be so far advanced that people assumed didn't exist yet. Or am I completely wrong about you? And the response from Agent Jay-Z is, you might remember this from a certain movie a long time ago. Well, a little bit, hang on. Everybody probably entertains the idea that it would be cool to be some sort of secret agent, even Agent Jay-Z. I don't recall ever being a participant in any government or military secret project or operation, nor would I be at liberty to discuss such operations if in fact they did exist. Thank you. Thanks for watching. Okay, we're outside now, normal glasses on. Engine storage / graveyard in the background. There's another bonus question I'm gonna answer because I get it all the time and I forget to put it in a questions video. And hear the answer. People ask all the time, what are those little flashing lights next to the engine when you're running it? Those, is there sparks or a flashing light? What's that little signal you've got going? Well, the camera doesn't pick up everything, but I do film in 1080, so you can probably notice when you see the video in high definition. See that? That's a little aluminum identification tag on the end of a sensor line. This one says oil pressure. Does it say oil pressure? It says oil pressure. And when that gets in the sunshine, can you see how that might look like a flashing light or a spark? Maybe? Maybe? We're in the shade right now, but you get the idea. When there's wind going through the test cell and the engine's running, and this is far off in the distance, sometimes that looks like a flashing light. And trust me, even if you're not convinced that's what it is, trust me, that is what it is. Okay, thanks.